Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. As a SciShow viewer, you can keep building your STEM skills with a 30-day free trial and 20% off an annual premium subscription at brilliant.org/scishow. Look at this cute, adorable, fuzzy little mongoose. It is a horrendous pest and a nuisance, and anyone who lives in Hawaii will tell you, do not be fooled by those beady little eyes. Mongooses are not indigenous to the islands, but they live there now thanks to a failed attempt at pest control. And yet, today, despite many catastrophic and well-publicized failures, some people say that using invasive animals as pest control is cost-effective, self-sustaining, and preferable to pesticides, even in Hawaii. To call this debate controversial would be an understatement, but at the end of this video, you should understand why anybody at all would advocate for doing this. So let's take a careful look at the successes and failures of this strategy, called biological control, the arguments for and against, and what we have learned that can help us do a better job of it. The term biological control covers a broad category of techniques. It can refer to things like conserving native predators to keep pests down. But we're going to focus on what people generally mean when they use the term, an attempt to control a particular pest species, usually an invasive one, by introducing new predators to the ecosystem. You see, humans have had this habit of introducing new pests to different areas, on purpose or accidentally. Rats, for instance. We've brought rats to many islands via ships, including Hawaii. Now, in the places they originally evolved, rats might not have been a big problem. Pests is, after all, a word with a lot of human judgment attached. In those places, rats were part of a whole ecosystem complete with predators to keep them in check, like owls or foxes or cats. But in a new place, like the islands of Hawaii, those naturally rat-eating predators aren't present, and without the pressure those native predators put on the rats' numbers, their population can explode and start really messing things up. Humans might dislike rats because they eat the food we're growing, but rats are also a danger to many of Hawaii's native birds. They've caused plants to disappear by eating all their seeds. They even eat sea turtle eggs. And rats are just one example. There are plenty of invasive species out there. Now, we can try to control rat numbers with traps, or hunting, or even poison, but these can be difficult to use. Rats are often pretty good at avoiding traps, for instance, and putting rat poison all over the forest would be difficult, expensive, and, you know, there are other animals out there who we definitely don't want to poison. So one idea to control rat numbers is to bring in some of those rat-eating predators instead, since not having them around kind of led to the problem in the first place. This is the basic idea behind biological control, as we have defined it. The predator, or sometimes a disease-causing pathogen, puts pressure back on the introduced species. That's a key point, since predator-prey interactions in nature basically never wipe out the prey species. Think of it more like a thumb on the scale, where the predator can manage the prey population enough that it's no longer a problem. To be fair, it doesn't always work out that way. One study looking at using insects to control other insects found that only 11% of attempts achieved complete control. Most of the time, the control agent couldn't establish itself well enough in the ecosystem to work, and just kind of died off. But when it does work, biological control can be very effective, and better yet, it can be self-sustaining, meaning you only have to do it once. If you were using rat poison, you might have to hire a bunch of people every year to go out and spread bait. But predators can just kind of refresh the program themselves every time they have babies, with their numbers expanding and contracting as prey populations change. Now, that might all sound really nice. You are restoring balance by having both prey and predator, right? But as elegant as this may sound, if you ask Hawaiians about it, well, they might have some other ideas. In fact, let's talk about Hawaii in depth real quick, because Hawaii has some of the biggest history with this whole scheme, for both good and bad. Now, Hawaii, of course, is an island chain very far in the ocean away from everything else, and it consequently has a lot of really unique species. Endemic species, or the kinds of things that aren't found anywhere else. You've got birds like the iiwi and the puyeo, mammals like the Hawaiian monk seal, and a ton of different plants like the koa tree or the hapu'u tree fern. These islands may in fact be home to more than 10,000 unique forms of life. But notably, none of those species are mongooses, which are originally found in Africa, southern Europe, and the southerly parts of Asia. They are never found in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. The story goes that back in the 1880s, there were a bunch of plantation owners on the Big Island who were all in an association together. They were upset about rats in their sugarcane fields and got the idea from basically some dude in the Caribbean to introduce mongooses to their fields. So they did, and the idea spread to other Hawaiian islands. But then the whole idea backfired. Mongooses don't just eat rats, they eat a lot of things, including some of those really cool native species. And once once the mongoose was out of the bag, so to speak, there wasn't any putting them back. They spread and went off into the wild and had little mongoose babies, and they are now just kind of there. Even today. And at the time, it was totally legal to do this. No regulations existed until 1890, when King Kalakaua of Hawaii passed some laws, but by then it was too late. And this wasn't the only example. One person, William Hillebrand, privately introduced the mina bird to Hawaii in 1865 to control army worms. Today, they compete with native birds for food. And of course, Hawaii isn't the only place this has played out. Cane toads in Australia may be the most famous example of biological control gone wrong. Introduced from South America to control beetle infestations, they instead killed a bunch of native creatures. They didn't even eat the beetles. In fact, they may have made it worse by eating the few species that were eating the beetles already. So yes, there are a lot of examples of biological control going bad, often due to the hasty introduction of generalists, species who are able to eat or affect multiple prey species. Cane toads are often said to eat anything they can fit their mouth around. And today, we know in hindsight that even without direct predation, a control agent can mess up an ecosystem. For example, the control agents themselves might end up as unexpected food sources for nearby predators. There was a case where scientists introduced a type of fly to an area only for the nearby deer mice to end up developing a taste for them. The influx of new food made mouse numbers more than double, much to the dismay of everything else that the mice like to eat. It's also possible that even though a certain agent might be fine here and now, that things will change in the future. Critters can spread beyond the original release area, or climate change may force them to move. Today, some of the worst invasive species anywhere were introduced as biological control agents, so it makes sense that people would be hesitant. But in kind of a mid-episode twist, it has worked sometimes, even in Hawaii. For instance, one of the invasive species that's come to Hawaii is the prickly pear cactus. Prickly pears are native to the American tropics. They were likely introduced to Hawaii sometime around 1809, and quickly took over large areas in some of the drier parts of the islands. In the 1940s and 50s, scientists looked at a couple of different species to try to control the cactus, including the cactus moth Cactoblastis. This time, they actually tested a bunch of candidate species before picking one to release, which is nice, since it turned out some of the candidates also liked eating pineapple. Which aren't native to Hawaii either, but we like them because it's pineapple. But I digress. The cactus moths worked, and they've been keeping prickly pear in check ever since. They've even been used in other places, like India. Another invasive plant, strawberry guava, was controlled after a 2005 release of a scale insect. In that case, researchers took a whole 15 years to investigate it before daring to release the insect. Elsewhere, ladybugs and a type of fly have been credited with saving the California citrus industry from a pest called cottony cushion scale. Then there's cassava, a staple food that feeds 200 million people in sub-Saharan Africa. 50% of it was wiped out by the cassava mealybug until the bug was brought under control by a biological control agent. So there are examples of biological controls seeming to work fairly well and without major negative consequences to the rest of the environment. So the question then becomes, what made these biological controls work where the others didn't? For one thing, unlike those early releases in the 1800s by just like anybody who felt like doing it, biological control is now usually subject to regulation and enforcement. In the United States, there were major laws passed in the 1970s, such as the National Environmental Policy Act. Many countries require risk assessments now before signing off on any real-life experiments. We've gotten much pickier about what makes a good biological control agent as well. Do not use generalists, for one thing. Today, scientists need to do some sort of test with relevant native species to see if the agent will affect them. If you're looking for something to control a plant, for instance, you need to do tests where you give candidates the option to feed, lay eggs on, or grow on the target plant. You'd also give them the option to choose other plants that are present in that area and hope that they don't use those. This may mean looking at several dozen candidates. Some scientists have also suggested expanding this process to include examining things like how the critters behave or the chemicals they might give off to understand as many potential interactions with the environment as possible. Scientists may also use models to predict what populations may look like years down the road and follow follow up with post-release monitoring to confirm. That is not to say the process is now foolproof. In the 1960s, a type of weevil was introduced to Canada to try to control an invasive thistle. Scientists thought these weevils were specialists, but it turned out they are not, and they began to attack native thistles as well. The scientists had tested the weevil before, but blind spots in how they set up the tests meant they didn't realize there was a problem until it was too late. So mistakes can still be made, systems must still be refined. And that leaves us with the question, is biological control a good idea? Well, I mean, ideally we'd just stop introducing invasive species, period. But some are already here, and we cannot go back in time. Proponents of biological control say it's better than letting invasive species wreck things, and they do appear to have helped save Hawaii from a few invasive species. We have examples we could point to where things have worked out. What's more, modern examples of biological control have a much better track record than the days of doing whatever popped into your head. But it requires a lot of study to get this right, and if you don't, it is usually a mistake that you are never able to take back, as those mongooses know very well. This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant. Brilliant is an interactive online learning platform with thousands of lessons in science, computer science, and math, starting with their course on mathematical fundamentals and going literally to infinity. Like, a course about infinity. And those mathematical fundamentals can help you calculate and wrap your mind around how many animals Hawaii could end up with when an invasive species population goes unchecked. This course uses puzzles and treasure hunts to guide you through variables, rates, and sequences, so you can learn middle school math concepts in a way that a middle schooler, or anyone else for that matter, would actually enjoy. Brilliant is giving these learning tools to you for free for 30 days. After that, you can take 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription by clicking the link in the description down below, or going to brilliant.org/scishow.